Carried.
I thought I'd just mention the resources. You've probably already seen them all. The new ones that we have, the DVDs are along here and CDs are along on that bottom shelf. And the publications and writings are here. Is everyone familiar with the movie guide? Yes. Yeah? Okay. It was just Margaret who hadn't seen that. These ones are new sets we've had made up. You may be familiar with some of the CDs, but each one has like a 5-disc set. Three audio CDs, a music CD with Music of Christ, and a DVD in it. So if you want to know any more about any of the content of them, just come and ask and I can let you know. But these are, I sort of was asked to make them up for the trip to Australia, and I've just picked like the best material that I really resonated with in terms of the quality and the content of them. So these are just really good sets. If you don't have any of the Awakening Mind materials, then these are really great.
Okay, what are they? Are you talking like the groups? Or?
Yeah, the audio CDs, the first two are an interview of David with a couple, David Paul and Candice Doyle, who do a lot of workshops for helping people get in touch with hearing the Holy Spirit. And so it was a 2-hour interview asking a lot of questions about what's it like to be the voice for the Holy Spirit and sort of his path and how that came to be.
They have a large readership, so they basically ask the readership to send in questions. And then out of all those questions, they said, let's pick the best questions or the ones that we feel like we would most want to be answered. So that's what they asked those, kind of in a, had them all laid out for themselves, and they just kind of asked them one after the next.
Yeah.
It's really clear.
Yeah, it's just fantastic. You can listen to it over and over. There's just so much in it. Beyond the Yuck was is a compilation of gatherings, that one. So again, just lots of questions that people were asking.
Lots of laughter, I think.
Yeah, lots of laughter.
Yeah, CDs.
Yeah, it's actually a 3-CD set, but I just put the first one in here. And the DVD was in San Pedro. That's another DVD, just again, lots of laughter and great questions.
It's nice to hear the witnesses. Like, I remember, San Pedro, I had a lot of fun with that one back in, whatever, 2004. And recently we were contacted by this man, a friend of mine named Kelly Love, that when Kirsten and Jason get back, they're going to be going to North Carolina to meet with Kelly and his group. It's the first Course in Miracles group in the history of mankind. It was in North Carolina. Judy Sketch went through there, and they said, let's get a group. Let's have a study group. And so thus was the first Course in Miracles study group. So they'll be going speaking to this ancient group that started by I don't know how many years ago. But anyway, Kelly, he was the first voice of the Course. He was the first one to ask to record the Course onto cassette tapes, so people who sometimes had problems with reading or just people who like to hear it more in an auditory way. He was the first one that recorded it. And apparently he wrote or called, or I forget how, I think he might have wrote, said that on the phone, said that basically his wife, all these years he's been a Course in Miracles student. We were talking about when one's a student and the other isn't. Well, here's Kelly, who was the original voice of the Course, who's been in the Course for many, many years, decades, and his wife is not a Course in Miracles student. And he said, they watched the San Pedro DVD together. She said, I think I want to study that book of hers. After all these years watching that DVD, I said, oh, thank you. That's very inspirational to know that it got used in that way. So she's watched him for every 25 years or more. Now this was like, okay, I think I'll...
That was my pick, yeah. I just picked one DVD to make the first set, and it was like, that's the one. Yeah, it's really inspiring. And all the angel music, Resta, who David mentioned, she had over 200 songs come through, And I made up, I think, 3 or 4 different compilations with a theme. So this theme I just pulled from that 200 odd songs, just the songs that are just about God's love, changeless love. So it's a beautiful meditation.
Oh,
compilation.
DVDs are there?
It's a CD. There's a music CD.
That's a CD, that's yeah. DVD and that's a CD.
Yeah.
All right.
So there's 1 DVD, a music CD, and 3 audio CDs of David speaking. Mm. And then the second one that we just had made up with a very happy smile. Huh? The first two, that's the other music CD, I don't know which order they're in, Gentle Awakening, so those songs were all about waking up. And this 2 CD set was the Atonement Talks. That was at the last Course in Miracles conference. The topic David spoke on was atonement. So they're great. It's all about...
There's a metaphysical talk
yeah.
and a transpertuning talk. So both pretty cool. Addresses everybody in the conference. If they have any particular block or whatever, it's like...
Yeah, they're great.
Yeah.
And you lead the first one off getting everyone to sing a song. So everyone...
I'm the Holy Child of God in heaven. it's a song that he wrote. I'm the Holy Child of God in heaven. I'm the holy light that shines always, walking through this world in perfect safety from darkness and from fear. I know I'll raise. And then the chorus is, I'm so happy. Imagine 500, or I don't know how many it was, 200 or 300, however we had there harmonizing. I'm so happy. After they're singing, I'm the Holy Child of God in heaven. They sang it from the top of their lungs. So.
They love it.
Yeah, they loved it. Kind of got a little bit of a bebop, hip hop, rap beat to it, and a little bit of this oriental thing in there. Really quite a fascinating song.
Got it.
Yeah, we can play it for everybody.
Yeah.
That might be a nice way to start our.
Session.
Yeah.
Yes. After Kristen finishes her Holy Spirit spiel.
And then there's
also that one too, the Atonement Talks. Yeah. Like there's tons of great parables of like that are just perfectly applicable to, you know, how it works.
How it works.
Just great stories. People in the audience were like, oh. They were like looking for an example, and there's a real connectedness in that.
You feel it.
Yeah.
Then there's No Control Over the World, talks on the Serenity Prayer, which is just fantastic. Like, it's all in a nutshell, all in one CD.
Yeah.
And then Joy, that's Colton Gathering. I called it Joy and Clarity, the Gathering in Colton, because it's just, there's so much joy in this gathering. And
you're singing, too. This is a Course in Miracles group that sings regularly. Like you would go to a church service, they sing their joy at the beginning. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Yeah. And you kind of, in that gathering, just went through, somehow it was just all laid out really clearly, just through the metaphysics. I just remember it was like, okay, step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4. It was like, just really clearly all laid out. So, that's those 2 sets. Everything's on a donation basis, so there are little cards there with suggestions, but, it's all...
Look at that. Did you say this is the best one? Or
they're both really good. That was the first one I made up, and then that was the second, like part 1 and part 2.
Which would you think would be the best one, though?
Part 1, yeah. Yeah. And then these magazines were our friend Raj in Australia, who organises all of the gatherings. They put out this journal... quarterly?
I think it's quarterly.
I'm not sure.
Quarterly.
And have you spoken about that? They were the editors, Raj and Suz, for years, and recently they've been having a guest editor come in, and basically they've said, pick your topic and provide us with the material, and then they professionalise it all and do what they do. So there's lots of writings in there that Jason did one, wrote one, David wrote one on Divine Providence. That was the theme. So, yeah, that's there if you want to flick through. And again, they're on a donation basis too. They have a suggestion of a price, but they gave us a bunch of those. So
kind of an international group too. Sylvia had one in there. Gary Renard, I asked him to write an article. He wrote an article in there. And we'll probably see Sylvia here one of these visits, because this year, she's from, see a photograph of her in there, but she's from Colombia, and she does a lot of meditations, and she's very devoted, and she was talking a lot about Australia this time. Before I left, she kept saying, I keep hearing Australia, Australia, so. Because I think somebody was asking too, they said, are you coming here annually? And I said, well, I think of our messengers group, there probably will be one or two or three or so coming probably on a regular basis. As the call comes in, we just go where we're guided, and so.
And now one of our friends, Russell, started a peace house in Newcastle?
Yeah, around Newcastle.
Can I speak to that? We're very, very fortunate that Raj in Australia is so generous, because with the amount of support that we can manage to rustle up in New Zealand, we couldn't afford to pay the international airfares and run a retreat without piggybacking on the Australian trip. So with Raj's generosity, and if you thank him for us, we
actually,
we
you and Mia got it going, though.
That's true.
They piggyback on you.
Yeah, this is true. So there was reciprocity there, wasn't there? So we're very fortunate, and I think after this retreat, if you can talk to everybody you know who could be interested for next year, and maybe get them to contact me, I'll put them on the mailing list, tell them how, you know, that if we really want this to happen annually, we are devoted, we're a devoted group, we want to awaken, and if anybody would like to join us, we'd love to see them. That would be tremendous, and it just means that we can keep getting these guys back to help us on our path, because it's such a blessing to have them here.
Yeah, it comes in different ways too. If you know somebody who even has frequent flyer miles, that's how it started for me. I just went around all around the United States and Canada for quite a number of years, just by car, basically, going very spontaneously. And then in 2003, I met this man named David who had won a prize. He was a world traveler, and he enjoyed traveling around the world, but he also collected frequent flyer miles. And he was on this trip, and it was like the Latin American Airlines were having a contest that if you flew on these segments, on these particular airlines, and stayed at these hotels and resorts, and ate this food and whatever, you could win the grand prize of 1,000,000 frequent flyer miles. Which he did. He won the grand prize. So then he had 1,000,000 frequent flyer miles on Latin American Airlines. And then when I met him, two or three days before I'd met him, we send these free CDs, Music of Christ, to people who request them. And I put them on the internet on a lot of different mailing lists and groups. And a friend from Argentina named Pat Posada basically wrote back and said, oh, I live in a far country, and I don't think you could afford to send me one of your free CDs, but I would love to have one. And so Resta wrote to her and said, I'll send you the whole set, like six or seven or whatever. So then Pat wrote back and said, so happy to hear that you're coming to Argentina. And told me about that, and I said, what did you say to her? And she said, I said someday we'd be open to travels. But we got the invitation, and then 2 days later I met this man David for the first time, and he basically said, have you ever thought of going overseas with any of this stuff? And I said, no, I never even gave it a thought. And I don't have one of those thingamajiggies that you need. And he said, passport, Dave. And so he said, well, I said, well, we did hear this woman that wrote 2 days ago and said, so happy to hear that you're coming to Argentina. And he went, Argentina? I love Argentina. Oh, I would so much love to go down there and take you along, and I could take two of your friends along, business class, fly us all down there. I said, how would that be? Well, you see, I won this contest, and I've got 1,000,000 frequent flyer miles I have got to figure out what to do with, and I was A couple of days ago I was praying to God saying, I love to go all over the world to do all these travels, but I said, I gave the million frequent flyer miles to God. I said, you know, these are you to use for your purposes. And so then 2 days later he met me and he said, I think this is what they're intended for. So he flew, four of us, Resta, myself, and Carrie and himself, down Ejecutiva. That's what they call Spanish for executive first class, Ejecutiva. So that's how the international travel started.
First class.
First class, which was good for Resta, because she's the one I mentioned earlier, was living a kind of a secluded life, and she would not have gone coach. Always knew that. Had to be Ejecutiva. So it was good too for leg space for me. I was like, oh, wait, Atkins, this international travel is not so bad. Like Lily Tomlin.
You got your hook and now this big body's got to fit in.
Yeah. So we have fun. And Jason's, he's really ready to go wherever. Give me a call, teaching me, so.
Right.
Argentina.
This
one. Next.
When
I'm freaking fire last year.
Yeah, the freaking fire last, so.
So you're using up, still using up the million miles?
No, he had a frequent flyer mile thing that he was waiting to see where the Holy Spirit would use, so. And then they donated, a woman who recently visited us bought Kirsten's ticket, so that's how they're making it down there to South America.
Wow. Yeah.
It comes in such wonderful ways. But. So this song coming up, this is, I know you're ready for it now. I'm the Holy Child of God in Heaven. As I mentioned, a little bit of rap, hip-hop, beat, and you'll hear the oriental sounds kind of in there too. And then these lyrics that basically come from the Course. Jacob is a Course in Miracles student. So. He has an interlude where it's just, you can hear, he gets into his God voice. In you is everything already accomplished. You know, I think you'll enjoy it. It's like Yoko Ono and hip-hop and rap all the world together.
I'm the Holy Child. Thank you.
song got its debut over in the country of Virginia from Sweden. They had a, the Swedes had the oldest Course in Miracles network in Europe, and they invited people from Norway, Denmark, all the Scandinavian countries, and they came together in a 17th century castle, invited me to come and speak at this castle. They had the translators of all the Scandinavian Course in Miracles books there, and they had a night where it was talent night, they called it, where people got up and recited poetry, sang songs, did dances, did skits, whatever.
Karaoke.
Karaoke, yep. They did the whole thing. And my friend Anna picked that song out, and she was going to get up and she got all dressed up to do a dance to that song. And she stood out, and everyone was sitting around in a circle, and she got there. And she said, David, get up here with me. So I get up there, and then she said, everybody. So it was like Dick Clark's American Top 40. Everybody was out dancing to I'm the Holy Child of God in Heaven. But it's just a lot of fun, you know, when people just relax. We were together, like we'd been together over the weekend. We were together for three or four days, and people just relax and enjoy meditating and walking and eating together and sharing stories, and it's kind of a nice, cozy, relaxed kind of family in a 17th century castle. Mm-hmm. It was kind of fun.
Family of 60 people?
Yeah, family of 60. That's where I met Jenny. Actually, Jenny came, everybody had pre-registered and come, but she broke the rules. She came in after it started. And she said, can I stay? And the people said, well, okay. And then they left her stay, and she was there for 2 hours and felt she received everything that she needed. And says,
I was really pleased. I didn't ask if I could stay. I had registered before, but I was late.
You were late.
I worked night.
And then tell the story about after 2 hours, you said you...
Yeah, I felt like I had got everything I came for. Mm-hmm. It was such a message. It was just came right into my heart, and I felt okay. I know what I came for. So I asked the organizers if I just said I feel guided to go home. I feel like I got what I came for. And they said, no, I think it's the ego, it's your ego that wants to leave now. and I just, okay, maybe they're right, because I was pretty new to the course, and I didn't really trust my own intuition, so I listened to them. So I stayed, but it didn't feel very good. I stayed for one day, and I thought, oh, well, maybe I can go and ask David about this. I asked you about, I said that I felt guided to leave after 2 hours, and they said I should stay, and you just said, should, is a word you never should use.
That's the right use of the word should.
In that sentence.
Yeah, so then I felt like it was very, really nice to be there, but I felt a bit confused because I hadn't followed that prompt that I had earlier. So I felt, okay, maybe I need to do it anyway. So I went home, but I, all the way home, I have this
guilt.
Talk to myself. Mm-hmm. No, yes, I'm guilt, but I just said to myself, okay, you have the permission to go back tomorrow if you want to, because this was a Saturday, and it was one more day on this retreat. So I just felt very calm, and I felt very determined to follow that, because I knew I would have many thoughts in the morning, but nobody, they would get everybody think when I come back. And yeah, I was very concerned about it. People would think. So I
realised that I had to be very determined myself. So in the morning I felt, yes, I want to go. So I took my car and drove this, 150 kilometres. And that was also a thing because so releasing this, I had so many thoughts about environment, and I would need to use the car so only for myself, and back and forth. And after hearing David saying that nothing is real or that, and I was so happy and such a release from all those old thoughts and ideas.
And then you stayed for the whole course?
What?
Did you stay for the whole course and finish?
I stayed for the rest of the course, yeah. Yeah. It was only one day. Yeah. And I felt the old feelings when I came, because this embarrassment to walk in there in front of everybody, to come back there. And they had breakfast, and I just walked in and sat down and by a table. And you just saw me immediately and came and had me. So it was very happy.
I gave her a hug and I just whispered in her ear, I said, "The prodigal daughter has returned."
And then I had another encounter with, there was a guy there. It seemed very strange because we sat down together and talked, and immediately I got so triggered by him, irritated by the way he spoke, and he told his story over and over again to different people, and a story about the past. He had a kind of awakening experience when he was a child, and he told the same story. I was so irritated, and it was the first time I met him, but felt like it was something special with him. In my car, when I was going to go back after this course, my car broke. And he lived like 10 kilometers from me. So I had to ask him if I could. So he drove my car. We took a rope and drove my car to a station. And we left my car there, and I had to go with him in his car. Yeah, and with this guy, and such forgiveness lessons.
Yeah, when I found out he lived close to you, and you, she was saying, "There's nobody else near me to talk to about these things and this and this." And I said, "I think Bengt lives nearby." And I said, I think you should be with Bengt. And she said, "Oh."
He's a single dad, and he has a son, and I have a son.
Yeah. Lots of parallels and mirroring going on.
Yeah. That's how we trigger him. I invited him for a retreat after, because last year I was with David in the United States and for 3 months, and then I returned to Sweden, and felt I had no one to talk to be with, because no one would understand me. I felt like I had gone through such a process, and I couldn't relate anymore to the people I used to, and I didn't recognize them all, almost. And so it felt like I had only him, and I felt like he isn't. I didn't want to be with him, but. I also thought, okay, I have something to look at here. So I invited him for a retreat, just him and me. And that was like a thunderstorm. Yeah, it was like both heaven and hell. One night I was just feeling I need to just meditate. I can't even look at him, and I was meditating, and he said, 2 meters away from me, and he just stared at me. He did almost all the retreat. He was so much onto me. He didn't look in his own mind. And he just stared at me, and suddenly he said, after maybe 1 hour or so, he just said, "Do you want to have peace or do you want to be happy?" And he just pointed at me. And I was just furious. It was rage, and I need to go. And I went out. It was in the middle of the night, and I walked out of the house.
Deep in meditation.
Yeah. And I walked out of the house and into my parents' house, and they were away, so I could use the internet. So I wrote an email to David, "This is what he's doing." And David answered, "Watch out for the ego in this." And this was helpful because I could go back and I could just watch what was happening. It's very helpful. And then, there's some more. You and Bill with each other.
How long had he been into the cause?
He?
How long had he been into the cause?
Me?
The guy?
He had been, I think, 10 years or so. 10 years, yeah.
And what was it that you found you didn't like? Was he?
Well, it was the something in his personality. It was his way of acting. His way of being so much on me instead of...
Right.
That triggered me many times.
So when love comes together, it brings up all this stuff because it feels that love is... Because love is being one, and we are love, when you meet somebody, it's like this chance you have to transform it to... So it does feel like hell, but...
Yeah.
Like you say, it can be heaven as well.
Yeah. Yeah, because when I got into this forgiveness mode, and I could be in forgiveness, it was so helpful.
It's a gift, really.
Yeah. It's like, but I had to be very, very attentive all the time, very... Mm.
Could you feel you have ulterior motives towards you?
I think he thought he had. Yeah. He had unworthiness. And of course I had too. But we got into this love relationship. So we had powerful, even physical, powerful encounters. But it flashed up guilt. I was really afraid because he said that the psychic had told him that he would meet his life partner last spring, and that was when he met me. And that's really stirred up for me.
Please, God, don't
look. She read that part of the chorus thing. Life partner could be hostile to one another. Perhaps for life. No!
Oh,
please!
And happiness.
Just on that subject, Lynn's mother and father were continually fighting. It affected her quite badly when she was younger. But.
Not physically,
no, verbally. But the first night I went home to see the family. They had their dining table in what was a big lounge, and they had a full-fledged fight in front of me as to who brought the salt in from the kitchen the night before. And I stood there and thought, what am I getting into? Incredible, and yet they stayed together until Bruce died, And I always said that the only thing that held them together was their arguing and their warring.
Because my mother would always rather be right than be happy.
Being counter.
Right is being happy to my mother.
Yeah, that's a good insight into what to let go of. Yeah. Sometimes you have to have the contrast, even throughout history, like Mary Baker Eddy. She's really known as definitely a contemporary saint who really could heal the sick, so to speak, or reached a beautiful state, a lofty state of awareness. And her father was like this fiery man who believed in fire and brimstone, the old way of God punishing. And I saw a picture of him one time, and he just had like a fire in her eyes. And so much of her life was a revolt against what she had experienced in him in childhood. Like she just couldn't believe in her soul that God was that way. And it was such a striking contrast that was presented to her in her biological father, that kind of, the Holy Spirit will use contrast at the beginning. When you're so addicted to misery, and you're so addicted to the ego, and you're not even aware of your own addiction to the ego, then it seems in the plan that you have to have some wake-up contrast experiences. Just like, you know, the defibrillator, you know, when they give an electrical charge to somebody whose heart has stopped beating, it's kind of a drastic measure, but it's like a last-ditch effort, you know, like, we've got to get the heart going again. So when the mind gets so enamored and allured and stuck in this world, then there seems to be some major contrast experiences. Kirsten's talked about her head injuries, kind of like a spiritual 2x4 whack. And then if it doesn't get you the first time, boom, another time. But it's such a contrast experience that after that, then made meditating, you had more of a purpose for meditating and working with the Course, because it was just like the old way wasn't going to serve anymore.
No, it was painful. Very painful.
Well, really, like, debilitating, too. Totally,
I showed myself that my way didn't work in a very graphic way.
I'm going from really headstrong and stoppy to when your wrists are broken and you have to be like little birds, you know, when little birds are in the nest, they have to open their mouth, feed me. It seems that's kind of a very humbling experience when you're used to being independent and doing everything for yourself. You know, that's a good example of one of those contrast experiences where you have to...
Going from independence to dependent.
Even from intellectual to, like, my path involves supreme intellectual. Like, I'm going to figure this out, and I'm going to get it, and as soon as I understand it, I'm done. And it was like, I needed an experience that showed me it doesn't work that way. So I went on this trip to Portugal with three kids and their mother, and... I was just kind of like an uncle hanging out with everyone, and we went out swimming to the beach. And apparently you're not supposed to swim there. But I told one of the younger girls, 16, I said, don't go too far. And she started swimming out. And I said, are you okay? She said, yeah. She said, okay. I look again, I'm like, are you okay? She says, yeah. I'm like, try to come back in. We're out, you know, maybe 30 meters. She started coming, and she couldn't make it. She said, can you come get me? So I swim up to get her. And I start pushing her in with these waves, exerting all my energy, and we're farther out. We're getting carried out to sea. I'm like, oh, that's it. All I got enough energy for is to scream. So I tried screaming as hard as I could. I could barely get my hands above the water. And the mother couldn't hear the waves. There was nobody around. And I'm like, ah. I looked at her. She looked at me. Nobody knew we were out there, and we're being carried out to sea. This is it. I'm like, wow, I didn't think I was going to go this way. I actually thought that was it. And we just kind of like shrugged shoulders, and I was starting to go under. I couldn't breathe anymore. I'm like, well, if I'm going to live, it's up to God. I can't figure my way out of this. And right after that thought, as we were heading into the rocks on the other side, this surfer comes out of nowhere and picks up her and I on the boards and saves us. So right after the thought, I can't do this by myself, It's like God sent us. And he told him, no, apparently someone far away on like a lighthouse had seen my arms waving and had called out to one of the surfers, and he came as fast as he could and picked us up. And it was a transformational experience of like surrender to the intellectual way. And I laid on the beach for like 5 hours.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Yeah. Yeah, that's a powerful experience because then it's like it sets you in a whole new direction of trust, a whole new depth.
Plus, I had the thought, wow, I'm done. There wasn't this sense of fear. It's like, oh. Everything else is a bonus, so to speak.
Yeah, it's good. It's, you learn to let go of all expectations in every situation. There was a singer-songwriter who traveled with me, Donna Marie Carey, who heard some of her music, I think, in the beginning. And she had a daughter who was about maybe 10, 11 years old. And one time Donna Marie said, well, my daughter would like to, and I would like to go on a little trip to you up to Michigan and to meet some friends, and can she, my daughter, bring a little friend of hers, another little girl, about 10 or 11 as well, and can we all go together? I said, fine, that'd be great. And so we got in the car and we were driving up to Ohio, up towards Michigan, where we would stop at this kind of little campground area, this lake, and swim together and so forth. And Donna Marie's daughter was in the back seat, oh, I don't feel so good, mommy, I don't feel so good on the trip, and then blah, threw up all on the lap of the other little girl. They're both sitting in the back seat, so they're all this vomit. So I pulled over to the service station, and went, come on, let's get in here, let's get you cleaned up. And cleaned up and everything, and back in the car we go, drive. Drive on a little bit further, we maybe go another 40, 50 miles. Okay, let's get you cleaned up here, you know. clean them up, in the back of the car. We drive another 40, 50 miles. the cycle's, you know. And the little girl's like over there with a towel, like protecting herself. So this goes on for a number, 3-4 times and everything. It's, we get up there, and Donna Marie, who's like a Course in Miracles teacher and singer, she's just like, oh. And so she's like, oh, I've got a throbbing headache, and oh, there's all the mother concepts, and the should-haves, and the would-haves, and the could-haves, and should we even take this trip, you know, all the hypotheticals whirling around, and what could have been different, what could I have done different, and, you know, false empathy, perceiving the pain of the little girls and all this and this. So we finally get up to Michigan and we get to the lake, and I'm like, okay, come on, let's get our swimsuits on and everything. And the girl's like, wee! And they ran off to change it. And so when I got mine on, and I was like, oh, just go, get away, you know. But it was all this perception, you know. It was like, oh, I didn't see a problem. And you know how kids are. They went through whatever they went through, and then they were thrilled when we made it to the lake, you know, to get out there and go swimming. And they were jumping around in glee as if nothing had ever happened. You know, just like, you know, like animals are that way. They're just so in the moment. So, but it was just a good, another good symbol about how you really just have to let go of the judgments and the roles. You only upset yourself. You only give yourself a headache or whatever, seemingly, when you hang on to these judgments and roles and expectations, and there's really no need in any situation, you know, to really buy the bait or to hook onto the problem, you know, because that's where the struggle comes in, difficulty. It's great with being around kids, that they love so many experiences.
It is a little book, I don't know if it's only in New Zealand, there was this little book called God on a Harley. Really nice little book. When you said about it, it was God on a surfboard. Like God on a Harley.
Yeah, I was with, one time I was in Indianapolis, I think, or St. Louis, maybe St. Louis it was, and giving a talk to a pretty large group of, most of them were psychotherapists. And I told the story of how one of my students one time said, "Oh, David, I can't think of anything better for my two children than to let you come up and house sit and let them spend like a week with you. That would be the best gift I could give my children." And so her husband was a pilot, so we're going to fly out and go off to some resort somewhere and leave you with the kids, the house and the kids for a week. We trust you with our kids for a week and everything. It should be a great experience for them. And so they said, okay, we're going to need here's some money in case you guys want to go out to dinner and, you know, just enjoy yourself and have a good time with the kids and everything. And they flew off for a weekend. And so basically, so much play. Immediately they wanted to rearrange all the furniture in the living room and get blankets and sheets and build like a little fort, a little house inside the house, you know, and get me down there and play. Oh, all kinds of imaginary games came out and this. And then we would lost track of the time. The days, the morning would go, the day would go and everything. And then we finally get to be around dinner time and I say, "What do you want for dinner?" And they go, "McDonald's!" Monday night, Tuesday night, "McDonald's!" Wednesday night, "McDonald's!" Thursday night, "McDonald's!" Friday night, "McDonald's!" Of course, they have Playland over there. You know, they, as children will do, they will try to test out your boundaries. They were like, "Whoa, Dave." They were like, they always like test to see what they can get away with. And I'm going to stay in non-judgment. I mean, they put me on a horse one time in Argentina, and the Kirsten went ahead, and the guide went ahead, and my horse was going off. I was feeding the horse as we'd go along, and if they wanted me to beat the horse or actually strike the horse, I was not. What's the point of striking a horse? I don't really care where the horse takes me. You know, so they were looking back. Kirsten went off and the guide was going off on the horses. And then they looked back. "Bartolo!" They were screaming at the horse and me. "David! Bartolo!" And we were deviants. But I'm not going to be getting a horse. I don't care what they say. So I was with the kids and we were just having this joyful time together. And the kids were like really loving it because it was like, it was non-judgment. There was no boundaries, there was no limits. And they were playing and having a good time in McDonald's every night and this and that. And so at one point the children got so happy. Like they were what you might call giddy. They were actually getting deliriously giddy. They were so happy. And I think the little girl, and then her brother was a couple years younger, the little girl went and spit. I remember I had that beard that you saw in there, so I remember just in slow motion I could see the little goober. You couldn't have a camera on that one, slow motion, see the goober flying over and landing in the beard. And I remember just in total joy looking at the whole thing, following it over and landing in the beard. And then, of course, they looked again to my face and my eyes to see, is this wrong or is this bad or whatever? And when I just kind of smiled back, they were like, "Spit bath!" So her and her brother, spit was flying all over the place. We all had a nice spit bath, went in, showered, continued on with the next game. I was telling this story to the about 30 psychotherapists who were going, they were shaking their head. I'm saying, "Dave, there's no sense of boundaries here. This is destructive. You've just been destructive in the children's lives and all this and this." And I said, "Oh, no, no." I said, "You have to understand what the point is. The point is non-judgment. It's reaching a state of complete non-judgment, which, of course, animals feel it, you know, you have animals come up to you when you're in a state of non-judgment, non-fear. Children jump in your lap, you know, they want to play. They feel connected and joined because the state of non-judgment is a natural state. And the state of control and rules and whatever is an ego state. So people, they gravitate to that. So so I told that, and it helped. The psychotherapist would say, what kind of role modeling is that? You know, what kind of, you know, what were you modeling for these children? And I said, that's not how it works. We think we learn from behaviors, but really it's all telepathic. You have the beliefs, you have the thoughts in your mind, and then the world witnesses to you your thoughts and your beliefs. It's not like children don't really learn from the behaviors of their parents or their siblings. It's all going on in terms of beliefs and thoughts. There's no transfer going on in terms of visuals. Learning, you don't really learn from behavior. So there really is no such thing as role modeling. But in fact, you know, a lot of times children, they feel the hypocrisy. The parents are making up all these rules and saying, it should be this way, has to be this way, I'm in control as long as you live in my house, it's my way or the highway, and this and that. And then the children see the hypocrisy of the parents breaking a lot of their own rules, and then start to think, why should I follow you? Who put you in charge of me? Who says you can make up the rules? It's because you got a bigger body. What gives you the right? You know, it's the rebellion part will come out. So anyway, we had a great, great week. In fact, they had so much fun that they were like saying, do we have to let the parents back? Do we have to let them come back in the house? And but it was good, because then when we got back, we had beautiful integrating discussions with the student and her husband, because, you know, the children had learned so much in terms of being intuitive and flowing with their intuition. And there was a time, too, where I took the boy came down to see me in Cincinnati, and we went to see this movie called Little Buddha. And in the scene, there's a transformational scene where Siddhartha goes from being a man into the Buddha. He has to face all these temptations coming at him, sitting under the Bodhi tree and facing dancing girls and flaming arrows and all kinds of temptations of the world. And little Matthew, he was maybe like 7, 8 years old, he had a very strong voice, so he wanted to sit with me in the movie theater while we were watching this very metaphysical movie. And basically, his mother said, okay, you can sit with David, but you have to sit in the front row, because sound will travel. You can't be in the back talking to David in the middle of the movie, you'll disturb all the other patrons. So he sat in the front row, so did I, we sat next to each other. We're watching this movie, Little Buddha, and finally Siddhartha's there, just sitting there in the lotus position, very still, and all these temptations are coming up, and Siddhartha's not even moving, not in the least bit deterred by all these temptations and everything. And little Matthew's sitting next to me, and he looks up to me in the middle of the movie, and he points at the movie screen, and he says, that's a powerful mind. And I said to him, yes. It is. So we watch more and more temptations come. Siddhartha doesn't unface, doesn't move anything. Little Matthew says, I will have that mind, the 7-year-old says, he's watching the movie. I go, yes, yes indeed. So then we watch a little bit more of the movie, and Siddhartha's like a rock. He's not fazed by anything that the world's throwing at him. Anything. Matthew's good. I am that mind. Ah, yes, yes indeed. It's like people sometimes say that the children, you know, can't be spiritual. They've got to go through all this ego development and this and this and this. But I see the children are just symbols of a state of mind. So I had no parameters on the thinking of the child as a child. You know, it's just a reflection of my mind. So in that sense, you just, everything can be used for the maximal. You don't have to talk to children as if they're children. If you can release your mind from the belief that children are children and see that everything is a reflection of your own mind, then to that extent they can reflect back to you what you have in your mind as well. You free them, you know, to be that way too. So it was a very powerful time with those children. We had a number of powerful experiences where we just took the parameters off.
Yeah, kids can teach us tons of happiness.
The same little boy would, he was up in Traverse City, Michigan, but basically when the ice would melt in the spring, the bay would be extremely cold. because the ice had just melted in the bay, and he would go out swimming. And people would like look out, like in March, in this bay up in off of Michigan, and they would be just like looking at him and almost in total disbelief that this little 7-year-old boy was out there swimming in these waters, and they would actually walk up and touch the water. Like, does this seem real? but again, that was just another good sign of mind over matter. You know, he was very happy and unaffected. It just shows how, you know, it's working on that mind training, and appearances deceive, but you don't have to buy into the appearances. Good example.
Was the parents, you know, like the week that they was away, when the parents come back, what was the relationship then? I mean, was the parents into the course?
Yeah, the Rhonda was a student of mine, and her husband Tom, he was open enough. He would later be open enough to having me and a group of people come up there and having like a little community in the house. I'd say they were very, very open to these ideas. And it really was very good for discernment. Like for example, Rhonda had this thing where she did not feel comfortable with the children watching a lot of violent cartoons or violent movies, sitting there and everything. She was the course student. She had discomfort around that. And then her husband, who was not into the course, would say, what's the problem? You know, if it's all an illusion and it's all just a bunch of images, why should we care of whether our kids watch these movies or not? He would say, I grew up watching violent cartoons all the time, Tom and Jerry, and the cat and the, you know, back and forth, how they would fight and fight and fight. And he'd say, look how I turned out. And she said, yeah, look how you turned out. You know, like, so then we, you know, we'd get deeper into the discussion. And it was, again, we'd have these discussions like, well, we have to go much deeper, because she intuitively was feeling that their minds were not trained sufficiently and to just sit there in front of a TV with what seemed to be violent movies just didn't feel intuitively right. And so we had to take a look, and I said, well, it's not the movies per se, but it's like, yeah, I think it's good that you don't feel to just leave the children there unsupervised, constantly watch those kind of things all day. I suggested to him then, if there's a particular movie or something that could be instructional, watch it together as a family, and let the children, with their curiosity, ask questions, and let the spirit pour through and use, if you're going to have that kind of a movie or whatever, use it occasionally as a teaching device where you can discuss. No different than the children see something on the news and go, Mommy, why did that happen, or this and this, and it can be an inroads to a deeper discussion. And actually, I have a friend, Alex, who's in Sweden, who's trained as a psychologist, and he was saying, you know, how do I work with my children? And he took it really far. I mean, he was going through A Course in Miracles with the three children, who were like 5 and 7 and maybe 11, 12 at the time. Particularly the 7-year-old, she was so tuned in. They were working the course lessons together. And at one point, I was in Sweden and I did a series of gatherings. And again, I was put with like 30 psychotherapists out in the woods of Sweden. I showed them the movie I Heart Huckabees, but before the gathering started, I had this little 7-year-old blonde girl, Sophia, who looked like a little teeny miniature of Madonna, like a little 7-year-old Madonna, come out, and that her father had taught her this course. They made a song up from lesson number 1 in A Course in Miracles about nothing I see means anything. And it had a nice little tune to it, and they sang it in front of these 30 psychotherapists, and the psychotherapists were just like blown away. Then we showed them the movie I Heart Huckabees, which was very funny but very metaphysical, and that just opened the discussion up. Most of these psychotherapists weren't even, had never heard of A Course in Miracles before, but by the end they were just lit up and glowing. So it was all just orchestrated. They had this very funny movie and this little seven-year-old singing a version of lesson number one from the course, and that got them, hooked them into that.
So the psychotherapists that have, you know, got to have ground rules and, you know, and this, that, the children, when they was introduced to the Course in Miracles, it completely changed their perception.
It starts to, it definitely puts them in that direction, you know, where they're listening from a lot of their conditioning.
So when they go on and deal with patients, it would be totally different.
I think they all come, well, not all of them, but a lot of therapists come from problem. And so if you're battling away at the problem,
yeah.
Of course, in Miracles, obviously, there is no problem. So I imagine it would be much thrown for a loop, because everything they're concerned with is fixing something.
I think it's quite interesting, because my friend Alex, for example, he was trained in psychology. He and his partner Anna were psychotherapists. And the deeper they got into the course, you know, Anna was used in many ways in her counseling skills, and she was drawn beyond that. Now she's working with like three kids and two foster children. They both were guided by the Holy Spirit out of the whole psychotherapy field. They're no longer even in the field anymore. But they went through a series of ways where they were used. The Holy Spirit would come through them. And then finally, I think Alex got to the point where he was working with a patient and he let all this teaching come through, and very rarely would he even mention A Course in Miracles in that kind of context. But the woman kept asking him, is there any additional reading? Is there any additional materials and books that I could read? Please, please. And so he mentioned A Course in Miracles. Well, some older psychologists found out about it, and they basically decided that he was in malpractice and that he should be blocked, removed from the field. And initially he called me and we Skyped, and he said, this is kind of like a major lesson here. It's almost like I seem to be under a siege or under attack. You're just even mentioning the phrase A Course in Miracles over here, and he kept seeing it as just a forgiveness opportunity, and he would meet with them, but they were very determined. And it got to a point where he tried to almost kind of put up a little bit of a defense or fight, and it just, nothing was happening. And so basically, he was guided out of the whole field. And then now he has foster children, and he can read the course and other materials and meditate at home as much as he wants. And Holy Spirit guided him in a way, in a direction that he couldn't have even foreseen. But he's there, and he and his partner have many, many opportunities with these five children, you know, for trusting and listening, and foster children that come and go. And so it's all being used for undoing the ego, but it's sometimes the ego can get set, like, well, wait a minute, I went through all this psychological training, and I thought, sure, I was going to be a psychotherapist, and then the script takes a big turn in a whole other different direction. And if you can relax and just move with it, then you see it's beautiful. Everything that's happening is all part of a beautiful plan. But when you judge it and you think, wait a minute, this is a bad outcome, you know, how dare they? And that's when the ego, you know, gets all stirred up.
But if they don't move away from being a psychologist and stay within that, it's like going back to the drawing board?
Within psychology, for example, there's many
many
therapy modalities, from stimulus response all the way to more behavioral, all the way to cognitive therapies, and then I would say humanistic and transpersonal. But yeah, they got much more into cognitive therapies, which is thoughts, changing your thinking, rational emotive therapy, and those kind of things, and then moved more towards transpersonal therapy, which is actually designed to undo the ego. It's actually a field of psychology that has recognized the great spiritual wisdoms, and that it's not problem-oriented, it's actually designed to help you undo the ego. And there are many transpersonal psychologists that study the course around the world, that integrate the course into their practice. So it's highly individualized. We were talking about that a little bit earlier this morning at breakfast, that, you know, it's like it's highly individualized on how the Holy Spirit will guide you and prompt you. So we can't say that there's set guidelines and rules that people should necessarily leave professions, switch professions. It's kind of like what we were talking about with relationships. It takes a lot of discernment about staying in a relationship or moving on from a relationship. And it's not something we should make like rash decisions and hasty decisions. You know, we should really pay attention to the signs and symbols and consult the Holy Spirit and not get tricked by the ego into thinking you can just simply move on from a profession or a relationship and find relief in another haven. This is like the Course is saying, there are no havens in this world. You can't find a haven from guilt on a battlefield. It would be like a war scene, you know. Guns are flying, tanks, bombs and everything, and you're looking around for a haven right on the battlefield. And Jesus is saying, don't even try it. This world is like a battlefield, and you need to go for the haven in your mind. Go for the haven of non-judgment. Go for the haven of forgiveness, of changing your perception, where you will find safety, and you will find a true haven. But sometimes people go for it in relationships. They think, oh, I just got to find me a peaceful mate. And then they get there and they go, yipes, what's this? Where did this monster come from? I thought you were a peaceful mate. So you see how you have to go inside for the healing and for the haven.
When you talk about Sriram, I don't know if we can talk about it.
Yeah. Any particular thoughts?
Yeah, it's memories from. It was about how I. I just got a memory of a particular event, how I treated my son. And also something from last summer when I had to care of these two other children when I really wasn't in that state. There was so much going inward and couldn't really take care of children. But this thing with Victor was when he and his friend had this place in the hair.
Mm-hmm.
And his
friend, lice?
Yeah, lice. This is called lice.
Lice?
Lice.
Head lice.
Head lice.
Head lice, okay. And I had to go to buy something to take that out, and I was in a hurry, and Victor was, he often was so stubborn, he didn't want to come with me when I was going, and I knew that this store would close in a particular time, and I was in a hurry and I couldn't wait for him to decide, and he was so stubborn, and and this other mother waited for me to go to buy these things. For me it wasn't important because I didn't really believe it was a problem, but I had beliefs that I had to do things for others, so I had to go anyway, and I said to my son, I really need to go now, and you have to decide if you want to come with me or not. And he just cried and said, I don't want you to go. And he stayed in bed, and I said, okay, I'm going now, you can come if you want. And he was screaming and crying, and I went out to the car, and I felt so much guilt, and I went off with the car, and I didn't see that he came out running. It was raining, and he came out without his clothes, and he just cried, and he ran to try to come with me, but I didn't even see him. So I went off the car and I was away for 1 hour or so. And I returned and he was still crying and he said, you didn't see me. And I wanted to come with you and you didn't see me. I just feel guilty because I feel something different.
Yeah. So, and if we listen to that and you take it into the feeling guilt and how it played out and this and that, the trick that the ego uses is the ego wants you to feel guilty based on the form of something that you did, that you think you shouldn't have done, or something that you didn't do that the ego would say you should have done. So it wants the guilt to be associated with the form. And what you learn as you work more with Jesus in the Course is the guilt always comes from the thoughts. In other words, just in reliving this memory occurred a while ago, how many months or years?
Two or three years.
So it's a memory from the past coming up, and then the emotion is still feeling, the emotions coming up, guilt.
And also now that left him.
So he's over in Sweden and you're feeling guilt and so forth. So if you take the guilt's not coming from any of the behaviors, as it would seem on the surface, but the guilt is coming from the thoughts of harming, of abdicating on responsibility and so forth. And of all the children in the world, that this seems to be, of the 6 billion people, there's lots and lots of children. You have guilt around this particular child, which is called Victor. Not so much with the other children. You don't have recurring memories of guilt with other, so many other children, but it's like, and what is that based on? And if you bring it in further and further and further, you can see that it's based on the self-concept that once you come to this world, you fall asleep, the ego makes up a substitute identity. And whether we're identified as father, mother, sister, brother, whether we're identified as Course in Miracles student, Course in Miracles teacher, as a Swedish person, or New Zealander, an Australian, an American, and so on and so forth, this concept of that's made up of all these different concepts becomes the false identity. And then we've got this false identity, this mask that you wear in this world. And with this mask, this mask is very volatile. You know, it's very, it feels unworthy. It feels like it's never good enough. And so if we pick an aspect of the mask, I would say the aspect is, we'll use his mother. And that's another concept. Mother is a concept, it's not a reality, it's a concept. And then when you look at that concept, and it's part of an identity, then there's an ideal that's attached with that, in the sense of being a good mother. You know, and there's a lot of guilt with being a good enough mother. How good is good enough? And you can pick the concept of mother, if you want to use it, or you can pick other concepts, but the ego has made up these concepts, and they're like ego ideals, and whenever you judge yourself as not living up to the ideal of an ideal mother or an ideal father or so on and so forth, then that judgment is a self-criticism and a judgment, and that judgment is where the guilt's coming from. Not from anything that happened on the screen. To use the example we were talking about last night, if you went to visit like a mass murderer, in a prison, you know, how would you see their innocence except having to overlook everything about them and seeing them as if seeing them for the very first time without a past? That's how you would see their innocence. And it's the same in this kind of thing, where as long as you're identified in that concept with the self-concept of mother, and as long as you hold Victor in that relationship, then there's going to be guilt over, you know, did I do enough? Did I do the right thing? You know, there's an evaluation that's being that's held in with that memory, and that's where the guilt's coming from.
And it's very strong, and I can think too that I need to pay him back. I owe him something now.
Mm-hmm.
And when I have paid that back, then I can see, then I can let go of the concept.
Yes. I remember we talked about this about a year and a half or ago, and when you went back to Sweden, that's you found yourself trying to do exactly that. Trying to pay him back, trying to be the good mother, go to the football games, attend the things, do the things that a normal good mother would do, and did that relieve you of the guilt? No. So again, we start to see that only forgiveness is going to heal this thing. No matter how you play act, no matter how much you try to live up to the ideal, did I do enough? It's like saying to God, was that enough? Did I love him enough? Did I do well enough? Am I a good enough mother? Did I pass the... Do I get back into heaven? You know, was I a good enough mother? Was I a good enough father? Even with Course in Miracles teachers, you know, they get into working with the book, and am I a good enough student? Did I do it well enough? Did I achieve enough with it? Did I reach enough inner peace? Will you let me back into heaven? You know, as long as we have these ego ideals, which were set up by the ego, and we try to live up to those ideals, it's a trick. We always judge ourselves in comparing. You know, the ego would say, oh, bad mother. There are many better mothers. You've been a bad mother, or fill in the blank, bad father, bad this. And it's through this mechanism of the mind, of comparison, that keeps the guilt in place. And it's more of like an ego ideal. I mean, the concept of a mother or an ideal mother is kind of a concept that is set up by the ego that you can never fully reach and attain it. It's set up as a guilt trap. So they keep you.
The comparison thoughts keep the guilt in place, yep. But to actually see the concept as the release of the guilt.
Yeah, once you can see the concept for what it is, and then you feel a sense of happiness and joy and freedom, because that's what forgiveness is. It just sees the false as false. Then you are open to receiving guidance. And of course, this guidance will bless the whole universe. It will bless Victor, it will bless everyone. A happy you, a guilt-free you, an innocent you, is going to be the greatest blessing for the whole universe. In fact, that will change all the relationships.
How could I see that concept as it is right now, when I have these feelings?
Well, what I would always do is, I see it as specialness. So for example, when I first started traveling with the Course in Miracles, you know, I would call home, talk to mother, talk to dad, talk to grandma, talk to grandpa. You know, I would like talk through, and I felt still a sense of missing them, or a sense of longing for things to be different, and so on and so forth. And then I would just ask myself, gee, that's kind of interesting, but I keep thinking about them. Out of the 6 billion people, what makes this handful of people so special? Why are they so special and unique? Why am I so unconcerned with most of the 6 billion and so concerned with this few handful of people? It's because, well, there's an identity tied in. They're mom and dad, you know, that's my sister, da da da. And then I would start to take it in deeper towards what is my calling. And my calling was to go deep inside and just to expose this self-concept that was made up by the ego. And then the more I started to travel, I started to get this feeling in my heart like that one child was all children. So that there wasn't a such thing as a special child. And even I had students who would travel with me and miss their children, and only to find that when we would go to the gatherings, these children would run up to them, and it would jump and want to play with them, and this, and they started having this experience, like, wow, I'm having so much fun with these children that are showing up at the gatherings. It's kind of, is the Holy Spirit trying to teach me something here? You know, it was the same extending of love, but it was like the forms were changing, even though there were still children coming. So you start to loosen from the idea of possession, of ownership, of the idea, in the end, of my child, my spouse, you know, and that's what's going on. And also, it would be that, you know, when you have these opportunities to come together with Victor again, it's, again, these golden opportunities to teach what you would learn, to let the full extent of love pour through you, but in a way that's not special, you know, it's not special to one body.
I can understand to a degree where she's coming from. Years and years ago, when my children were young, I played the sport of judo, and I taught judo and all that sort of thing, and I had my children as well. And we used to have the children's class. I used to teach them, and they used to teach the seniors. And my children were playing with other children in our venue. It was a big football grandstand, and we were way up in the top of it. And one night my son was playing with the other kids. And he fell off the grandstand. And he ended up in hospital with a fractured skull. And wasn't expected to live. Anyway, he came through a lot eventually, and it seems to change him. And I think I carried the guilt of that all my life, because I wasn't actually there for him. Don't worry, that's a little bit so much. Anyway, he's alive now, married with five children, and he has a very, very bad depression problem. And I have probably overcompensated for years, and I've always been there for him, I've always been there for everybody, you know, I invented the whole thing. Anyway, I've always been there for him. Probably more than anybody else. Probably because I felt guilty. And he has a very big depression problem, and he's often spoken to me about it, and said he's, you know, felt suicidal at times, and he's in this very, very, very big dark hole. And he has a job and all that sort of thing. He's a very nice person, like a gentle giant, really, but I have probably carried this guilt all my life, wondering if it was my fault that he did this. And I can sort of see that, you know, it really wasn't my fault, and there was nothing I could probably do about it. So I can see where you're coming from to a degree, but, you know, I don't see that, you know, you have anything to feel guilty for.
You said one very helpful thing, that you were there for him, probably because you were so guilty.
Yeah, well, I did. I felt guilty and felt guilty all my life.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's nothing I can do about it, but I have to keep giving it up and giving it up. But it has affected some aspects of my life.
Yeah, those recurring thoughts could it have been different? Could it have been prevented?
Yeah.
And if you really trace those in, it's like, you know, could I have been a better father?
Oh, yeah. That,
you know, that's underneath it. Yeah, and that's what I mean with these ego ideals. Yeah. When, I mean, one time I was talking with a group up in Michigan, and we were getting into this concept of guilt. And people were just all saying, a whole room full of people saying, how can we be free of this guilt? It's deep, it runs so deep, it's so intense, how can we ever be free of it? And I went around the room and I said, okay, I want you to all tell me what you feel guilty for. And there were people talking about guilt around their children, the way they'd raised their children, guilt about not paying back money to friends and people that they owed, guilt about various mistakes that they'd made, judgments, and so on and so forth. And I went around the room and listened. It was like a guilt parade. Everybody was pouring out all the stuff that they felt so guilty for. And in the meantime, saying, help us. We're carrying this burden of guilt. You know, it's a very heavy burden to carry through life. And so I said, okay, now we went around the room. I said, now that you've poured out all these things you feel guilty for, can you take it from the specific event that seemed to occur to what is the role that you were playing? What is or what are the roles that you're playing? And they've talked about, you know, a father, a mother, a brother, a sister, a citizen. They talked about all the roles that they were playing that was tied in to these events. And I said, can you see a way that you could be completely innocent and completely guilt-free and still maintain the roles? And they all went around and said, no, we can't. I said, very good. This is a setup. This world and these roles and these guilt feelings are all a setup by the ego to keep you from really experiencing love and true happiness and joy. It's a big setup. It's like a big, giant game that was set up to maintain guilt. That's why the world was made. God didn't create this world. And I've heard people for years, they say, David, love makes the world go round. And, well, it sounds kind of nice, but actually guilt makes the world. Guilt drives this world. This world is egos. When people say, I'm afraid of, I'll go to hell, I said, look around you. You think it's going to get worse than this? It's like the ego has generated a world of guilt. Guilty relationships. I could have done better. I didn't live up to my parents' standards. I didn't live up to my own standards. I didn't make the grade. I'm not good enough. I'm not worthy enough. I wasn't a good enough mother. I wasn't a good enough brother or sister or father. I wasn't a good enough worker. I cheated on this. I wasn't a good enough spouse. You know, it's like a setup that the ego has set up to keep the mind trapped and feeling guilty. And what you start to realize is you will try to overcompensate, and that doesn't even work. You know, those emotions, here you are, Bill, and here you are, Jenny, you're still feeling those tremors, those guilt tremors still coming up, and even when you try to overcompensate and be an extra good dad or an extra good mom, that doesn't alleviate the guilt either, because the ideal is still held in place, and the comparison is still going on, and that's what's generating the guilt. So we're getting, and if we bring it back to what we've been talking about over the weekend, we're back to those private thoughts again. You can see in the movie last night, Ed TV, the guilt in the mother, the guilt in Ed, the guilt in the father, you know, it was playing out. The guilt in the sister, you know, when Ed's brother got on TV and said, what was she doing in a bar anyway? For Christ's sake, she's an alcoholic! You know, right on national television, you know. It was all this guilt based on all these private thoughts. And then we come back to the teaching of Jesus. These private thoughts are not real.